إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله Indeed, the most truthful of speech and the best of words are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم And the best guidance is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ Every going astray, every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدٍ My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah says, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says what means, and remind one another, for verily, the reminding benefits and it profits the believers. Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, he said the true believer is a guardian of his own self, and he continuously calls his soul to account for the sake of Allah. And the reckoning of the day of resurrection will be easy for those who always count their take account of their souls in the life of this world. And the reckoning of the day of judgment, of the day of resurrection will be difficult for those who live the life of this world without ever examining their conscience or calling themselves to account. عن ثابت ابن الحجاج قال قال عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا وزنوا أنفسكم قبل أن توزنوا فإنه أهون عليكم في الحساب غدا أن تحاسبوا أنفسكم اليوم Thabit ibn al-Hajjaj, he reported that Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, hold yourselves to account before you're held accountable. Evaluate yourselves before you're evaluated, yani by Allah. For the reckoning will be easier on you tomorrow when you meet your Lord and you're questioned if you hold yourself accountable today. There is a book written by one of the students of Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah, entitled The Grave. And it goes through the whole situation of the life in the grave, and that's a different khutbah topic for a different day. But at the end of the book, the one who wrote the book and compiled the book, the sheikh who did so, he had some questions for the people to reflect upon, to call themselves to account with, that come under al-yawm al-islami, the Islamic day, for the one who seeks the pleasure of Allah in this life and the next, and who seeks to have a grave that is wide and expansive, and one with furnishings from Jannah instead of punishment, and one who wants shade and protection on the day of resurrection, and one who wants Jannah to be his or her final and eternal abode. So we will reflect and focus on these questions over the next couple of Jum'ahs, and we will add some reasoning to why they were posed, for you to reflect upon, and why these came at the end of a book called or entitled The Grave, a comprehensive reminder to question yourself with daily. Hayat al-Yawm al-Islami, the life of the Islamic day for the Muslim who wants to make it to Jannah. The first question the Imam posed, and you'll see as we go through the questions, they will deal more with how you are as a person, whether you're angry, whether you're arrogant and proud, these likes of these things, how you are with your parents. But he started off by asking, هَلْ تُصَلِّ الْفَجْرِ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ فِي جَمَاعًا Have you prayed Fajr in congregation in the masjid every day? And this was from the first of his questions. Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu anhu, He said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من صلى العشاء في جماعة كان كقيام نصف ليلة ومن صلى العشاء والفجر في جماعة كان كقيام ليلة. رواه أحمد, مسند إمام أحمد, وهذا حديث صحيح. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever prays Isha in congregation in the masjid, they will get the reward as if they spent half of the night, 3-4 hours in prayer. And whoever prays Isha in the masjid and Fajr in the masjid the next day, then this person, it will be written for them as if they stayed up the whole night and never slept one ziz. It will be written for them the whole night they stood up in prayer. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من غدا إلى المسجد وراح أعد الله له نزله من الجنة كلما غدا أو راح. رواه البخاري. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah will prepare for him who goes to the masjid every morning and in the afternoon, every morning and in the afternoon, for salat al-jama'ah, for the congregational prayer. He will prepare for the one who does this an honorable place in Jannah with good hospitality for what he has done by going to the masjid in the morning and in the afternoon. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, of the first of his questions, where are you praying? Inshallah, you're praying Salat al-Fajr, but where are you praying it? Because the place without a doubt to be praying for the men of this ummah, and that's from the age of puberty up, is in the masajid of Allah. The second question, هل تحافظ على جميع الصلوات في المسجد جماعة? Have you attended all of the congregational prayers at the masjid? Where are you praying your prayers? Look at how everything, when the Prophet ﷺ, when he made his hijrah and he went to Medina, the first thing he did was not even settle his own home. He established the masjid. The masajid of Allah are for us to get together, to check in on one another, to make the ummah strong, yet they're deserted. A year ago, we had on this day, we had Jum'ah outside in the parking lot. A year and a half ago, the masajid were closed and people were complaining, and yet the lines still don't even complete one saf. If they do, you're in the second one halfway. So we can complain about the masajid being closed and yet we're still abandoning them. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he mentioned that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Salatul Jama'ah tafdulu Salatul Al-Fadhi bi 27 daraja. Rawah al-Bukhari. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the prayer of a person in Jama'ah, in the masjid, is better than 27 times the prayer of the one who prays by himself or by himself. 27 times. If you give a 2-year-old 27 pieces of candy or one, they'll pick the 27. If you say you'll give someone $27 or one, they'll pick the 27. Yet here we are, knowing we want to make it to Jannah, knowing that there is a mizan that will weigh our deeds on the day of resurrection, knowing that we need all the help we can get because of the sins we pile up, even sins we're doing, we don't even count as sins, but they are sins. And yet here we are, giving away this hasanat, this ajr, as if we don't need it. Allah said, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجَدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ وَلَمْ يَخْشَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَعَسَىٰ أُولَٰئِكَ أَن يَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُهْتَدِينَ. Allah says what means in Surah At-Tawbah, the masajid of Allah, they are maintained by those who truly believe in Allah. And they believe in the last day. They know that Allah will question them and that their scales will be weighed and that there will be a sirat laid over Jahannam for them to cross. And they perform the salah and they give the zakat and they fear none other than Allah. So we must ask then, if you're not attending the masajid to maintain them, this is not with your wealth, this is with you attending the prayers here on a daily basis, then are you one who truly believes in Allah and the last day? Do you truly establish the prayer and give the zakat? Do you truly fear only Allah? It is they who are expected to be on true guidance. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he mentions that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسُ مَا فِي النِّدَاءِ وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا إِلَّا أَن يَسْتَهِمُوا عَلَيْهِ لَأَسْتَهَمُوا وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِي التَّهْجِيرِ لَأَسْتَبَقُوا إِلَيْهِ وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِي الْعَتَمَةِ وَالصُّبْحِ لَأَتَوْهُمَا وَلَوْ حَبْوَى. This hadith that we find in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, if the people knew the reward for calling the adhan and standing in the front row of the congregational prayers And they found no other way to get there except by drawing lots. They would draw lots. Alhamdulillah, on the yani, to extend that, at least there's the prayers established here, but you can make the front row on the daily prayers. All you need to do is come. And if they knew the reward of coming to the Dhuhr prayer in its earliest status time, they would race to it. They would race to it. They would go early just to make sure that they're in the masjid for Dhuhr prayer to pray it when it's called. And if they knew the reward for Isha and Fajr, the morning prayer and the evening prayer, to be prayed in Jama'ah, they would come even if they had to crawl. Even if they had to crawl. I don't swear by Allah typically. But if many of us knew that there was a briefcase of money in that corner and you had to crawl, you would crawl. Here Allah is promising you reward, abundant reward, being from His believers, protection on the Day of Judgment. If you just come to the Salah, you don't have to crawl. You have feet. Many of us, alhamdulillah, have feet, have legs, are not in a wheelchair. We have cars to protect you from the weather so that we can still come. You have bikes if you need some other mode of transportation. You can call Uber even if you really have no other means of getting there. But that's how deficient the love for the masjid is in our hearts. And we can go over many other things. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ saying that he would burn the homes of the people who didn't come to the prayer, who had no excuse. For the men who didn't come out to the prayer with no excuse. And if it wasn't for the women and the children, he would have done so. To show how it is wajib, it is obligatory for us to pray in the masajid. هل قرأت اليوم شيئا من كتاب الله? Have you recited anything from the book of Allah today? Where's the masahif in your home? Not the decoration ones, the ones that you actually read. Are they being taken out? Do you read from them? And I'm telling you, even go back to reading from the mushaf and stay away from the phones. And reading the Quran just on the phones. Because the mushaf is, yani, from the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It contains the words of Allah. His actual speech, His message to mankind. If your loved one gave you, and I said it before, a letter, you would read it every day. You would memorize it. You would safeguard it. It would be a treasure to you. Allah gave us all a direct message to save ourselves so we can see Him in Jannah and be of His inhabitants of Jannah. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ Allah said, this is the book in which there is no doubt. There is no doubt placed in it. There's no contradiction in it. There's no change that will be made to it. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ It is the guide for the ones who want to be the muttaqeen, who want to have that taqwa, who want to be from the righteous and the pious, the God-fearing, the God-conscious. Abu Musa radiallahu anhu, he narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, تَعَاهَدُ الْقُرْآنِ فَوَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَهُوَ أَشَدُّ تَفَصِّيًا مِنَ الْإِبْلِ فِي عُقُلِهَا رَوَاهُ الْبُخَارِي The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, commit yourself to the Qur'an. Safeguard the Qur'an. Refresh the Qur'an. Read regularly the Qur'an. For by Him in whose hand is my soul, it is surely more prone to break away from you than a camel in its bind. And we see it. Many of us, tunes, melodies, songs, you haven't heard for 20, 30 years, you remember every word of that lyric. Even how long they stretch out the words or whatever it's called in music or whatever. But the Qur'an, you memorize it. And if you leave it for a week, you leave it for a month, you leave it for some time, it goes away from you. And you start forgetting it. This is the book of Allah, the words of Allah. Al-mamdud min as-sama'i al-ard, hablullah. It's the rope of Allah outstretched from the heavens to the earth. فَتَمَسْتُكُ بِهِ Hold on to it. Hold on to it. Abu Umama, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard him saying, اقرأ القرآن فإنه يأتي يوم القيامة شفيعا لأصحابه. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, read the Qur'an because it will come on the day of resurrection as a shafi'ah, as an intercessor for its companions. That day of fear, as we will see and hear, that day of terror, that day of worry, that day of anxiety, yet there will be some who the Qur'an will speak on their behalf and beg Allah to forgive him and have mercy on him and admit him into Jannah. Who does not want that? Unless you don't believe it's true. Who does not want that privilege to be from the people of the Qur'an? Malik ibn Anas, radiallahu anhu, he narrated in a merciful form that the Prophet ﷺ said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ أَمَرَيْنِ لَمْ تَضِلُّ مَا تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّةَ رَسُولِهِ. He said, the Messenger of Allah ﷺ said, as long as you hold fast to two things, you will never go astray. This two things that I left amongst you, the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, and Shaykh al-Albani Hassan had the hadith, he graded it as Hassan. These two things, one for each hand, hold on to them, you won't have the problems of going astray. هَلْ تُثَابِرْ عَلَى الْأَذْكَارِ وَالْأَوْرَادِ عَقْبَ كُلِّ الصَّلَاةِ. Have you persisted in the remembrance which are said after every prayer, the remembrances? Noting that when you're sitting after the taslim, after the salah, and you haven't spoken to anyone, and you're remembering Allah, the malaika, the angels say, Allahumma aghfir lahu, Allahumma arhamhu. The angels, the malaika, they are making dua for you. A person of this dunya, a person who was a sinner, oh Allah, have grant forgiveness to them, oh Allah, have mercy on them. For just sitting and making that dhikr. Thawban, the freed slave of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said when Allah's Messenger wanted to, when he finished his salah, he would seek forgiveness from Allah three times. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Why? Because of the taqseer in the prayer. Because of the shortcomings in the prayer, the mind wandering in the prayer, he would seek forgiveness from Allah three times and then say, Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. O Allah, you are the one free of defects, and perfection is from you. Blessed are you, O possessor of majesty and honor. To say this dhikr after every prayer, to ask Allah for forgiveness, because we know our prayers are not perfect. We know our minds are thinking of what we have to do after prayer. Just to say something so soft on the tongue, so light on the tongue, 6 seconds of your time to seek forgiveness from Allah and grant and say this praising of Him. And this is the response on Yawm al-Mazid, on the Day of Increase, when Allah calls the inhabitants of Jannah to see Him. And Allah will greet the inhabitants of Jannah, Salaamun Alaykum. And the response will be, Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. So every time you utter it, make dua that you're from the people of Jannah so you can respond to Allah's greeting to you. Abu Umama radiallahu anhu, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man qara'a ayat al-kursi, dubra kulli salatin maktubatin, lam yamna'hu dakhul al-jannah illa al-maut. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the authentic hadith, whoever recites ayat al-kursi at the end of every obligatory prayer, after the five daily prayers, just you recite ayat al-kursi, nothing prevents you from Jannah except that you have not died yet. Nothing but death will prevent you from entering paradise. Just by reciting ayat al-kursi, to recite it calmly and nicely, 20 to 25 seconds. Is this too much of your time? أَعْظَمُ آيَةِ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. It is the greatest ayah in the whole Qur'an. And it is the protector against the jinn and the shayateen. It's the protector against the jinn and the devils. Yet many people will just get up, the salah is done, and storm out. I get it. We lead busy lives. I get it. We have to go back to work, families, etc. I understand. But we're talking about 1 minute to say some of these minor adhkar. We all know the adhkar of the tasbih and the tahmid and the takbir. Saying, many of us just know it to be 33 times that you say, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, and you end it with La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lahu to the end, and the likes of this. But even when you're in a rush, the sunnah has variants. The sunnah has many options and things you can do. We'll share one of them in a partial hadith from Abdullah ibn Umar, where he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, خَلَّتَانِ لَا يُحْسِيهِمَا رَجُلٌ مُسْلِمٌ إِلَّا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَهُمَا يَسِيرٌ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلُ بِهَا قَلِيلٌ. قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الصَّلَوَاتُ الْخَمْسُ يُسَبِّحْ أَحَدَكُمْ فِي دُبْرِ كُلِّ صَلَاةٍ عَشَرًا وَيَحْمَدُ عَشَرًا وَيُكَبِّرُ عَشَرًا فَهِيَ خَمْسُونَ وَمِائَةٌ فِي اللِّسَانِ وَأَلْفٌ وَخَمْسُمِائَةٍ فِي الْمِيزَانِ وَأَنَا رَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَعْقِدُهُنَّ بِيَدِهِ. In this first portion of the hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said there are two qualities that no Muslim person attains, but he will enter Jannah. And they are easy, but the people who do them are few. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said the five daily prayers, after each one of them, say Subhanallah 10 times. And Alhamdulillah, 10 times. And Allahu Akbar, 10 times. This, if you do so, will make it 150 times in the day on your tongue. But your reward on the scales will be 1,500 hasanat, 1,500 rewards. And the narrator said, I saw the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam counting them on his hand, counting them using his right hand. So even when you're in a rush, to say Subhanallah 10 times, Alhamdulillah 10 times, Allahu Akbar 10 times, and look at the reward you get. Jannah is promised for you, for the one who does this and does them regularly. So even in the days you're in a rush, if you have to just say that 10 times, say it 10 times before you get up and you move. هل تحافظ على السنن الراتبة القبلية والبعدية? Have you upheld the voluntary prayers before and after the obligatory prayers? Have you upheld those? Yes, we know it's sufficient if you just did the fara'id, if you just did the 5 compulsory prayers. This from what we know from the hadith, this is sufficient. But the question has to be, what have you done with the voluntary prayers? The ones that will be looked at to make up for the deficiency in your obligatory prayers. Aisha radiallahu anha qalat, أن قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من ثابر على ثنت عشرة ركعة من السنة بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة 4 ركعات قبل الظهر وركعتين بعد الظهر وركعتين بعد المغرب وركعتين بعد العشاء وركعتين قبل الفجر رواه الترمذي وهذا حديث حسن. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever is regular, they're regular, they consistently do the 12 rak'ahs of sunnah prayers that we will mention, Allah will build a house for him or her in paradise. The 4 rak'ahs prayed as 2 and 2. You break those up into 2 rak'ahs and 2 to equal 4, before dhuhr. And the 2 rak'ahs after dhuhr. And 2 rak'ahs after maghrib, 2 rak'ahs after isha, and 2 rak'ahs before fajr. If you are consistent with those, Allah will build for you, specifically for you, a home in paradise. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ركعة الفجر خير من الدنيا وما فيها رواه النسائي وهذا حديث صحيح. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that the 2 rak'ahs before fajr, the 2 sunnah rak'ahs before fajr, they are better than this world and everything in it. Even when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was traveling, he prayed these 2 rak'ahs. Sunnah, he didn't do the ones with dhuhr, or maghrib, or isha, but he never cut off the 2 sunnah of fajr, before fajr, and the witr prayer, even when he was in a state of safar or traveling. In these 2 rak'ahs, what was his sunnah? It wasn't to read Surah Al-Baqarah, or Surah Al-Imran, or to read a long surah. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ Surah Al-Kafirun and Surah Al-Ikhlas. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. To make them brief, and they're better than this dunya and everything that is in it. وعن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رحم الله امرأ صلى قبل العصر 4. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in this hadith, which is Hasan in the Sunan of Tirmidhi, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he made dua, may Allah have mercy on the one who prays 4 rak'ahs before Asr prayer. Who prays 4 rak'ahs before Asr prayer. Revive the sunnah, ya akhwani wa akhwati fillah. Bring back the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So much we are neglecting and forgetting, putting behind us, putting aside, and we're leaving the best of guidance and the best of examples. Aqulu qali hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. Ad'u Allah yaghfir lakum dhunubakum. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as we're going to be doing at least between today and next Jum'ah, we're reviewing a set of questions that came at the end of a book entitled The Grave. And these questions were labeled the Islamic Day. The day of the Muslim, how he or she should live their life, what you should question yourself with on a daily basis to put yourself in the right. We left off at the question, هَلْ كُنْتَ خَاشِعًا الْيَوْمِ فِي صَلَوَاتِكَ مُتَدَبِّرًا مَا تَقُولُ. The next question was, when you prayed, were you in a state of humility in your prayer today? And did you reflect upon what you were saying? This takes that you make the ruku' and the sajda with calmness, with humility, and not rushing it. Because you can't rush through something and you're going to have that state of khushu'. This khushu' in the prayer, it is one of the aspects of the mu'mineen, and we want Allah to make us from the believers. We want Allah to make us from the believers on the Day of Judgment, where Allah gives us the title of the believer. Not for us to say we are one. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ Allah said, successful indeed are the believers. And then He gave their descriptions. The first one, those who in their prayers, they offer their prayers with solemnity, with humility, with full submissiveness, focusing on their prayers. Not just those who establish their prayers, but those who focus on them. Yes, it is hard. Yes, it is difficult. Yet it is humanly impossible to focus 100% of the prayer. But your trial, how you set yourself up, it starts when you make the wudu. And you come to the prayer calmly. And you know your clothes are clean. And your pants aren't dragging on the floor. And you face the qibla. And you take a breath. And you enter the salah with takbiratul ihram by saying Allahu Akbar. And you begin to learn the words and the meanings of the words that you're saying. This is how you will attain that state of khushu'. هَلْ تَذَكَّرْتَ الْمَوْتِ وَالْقَبْرِ Then the Shaykh, he mentioned from the questions, did you remember death and the grave? And yani, if you go and talk to other people, very rarely do they talk about death. It's become a cynical thing, a depressing thing, like a negative thing. And this isn't the way the Muslim lives his life. Because كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةٌ مَوْتِ Because every soul will taste death. This is a reality. And we talk about the good. We talk about living the goodly life. But we must also talk about the fact that it may end whenever Allah chooses for it to end. Did you remember death and the grave? Every day, in your prayer and outside of your prayer. It was narrated from Abu Huraira that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَكْثَرُ ذِكْرَ هَذَ مِنْ لِذَّاتِ يَعْنِ الْمَوْتِ That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, frequently remember the destroyer of pleasures. When you're happy, it doesn't mean you have to take your happiness away. It doesn't mean that you're not supposed to smile. It doesn't mean that you can't have a fun, good time. But you should frequently remember what will take all of that away. And it is death. Well, Abu Huraira, he mentioned that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا فَرَغَ أَحَدَكُم مِّنَ التَّشَهُدِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَتَعَوَّذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ أَرْبَعِ مِنْ عَذَابِ جَهَنَّمْ وَعَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ وَفِتْنَةِ الْمَحْيَا وَالْمَمَاتِ وَمِنْ فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ أَوْ مِنْ شَرِّ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ When the Prophet ﷺ, he said, when one of you finishes the last tashahud, he should seek refuge with Allah from four things. He should seek refuge in Allah from four things. Before you give taslim, before you exit the prayer, from the punishment of the hellfire, from the punishment of the grave, from the trials of life and death, and from the evils and the trials of the Dajjal, the Antichrist, the one who will come impersonating as if he was God or as if he was Isa alayhi salam. And then Prophet Isa alayhi salam will return and he will establish the truth and break the crosses and kill the pigs and abolish the jizya and follow and lead by the Quran and the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So even before he would exit every prayer, so at least five times a day, he would seek refuge with Allah from the punishment of the hellfire and the grave, and the trials of life and death and the Dajjal. Do you think about this on a daily basis? You have to start calling yourself to account. And I remind myself first, question yourself with these questions so that you live the life of the Muslim. Although there are many other questions, we will pause and continue with them. But before we go to the prayer, Alhamdulillah, yesterday we submitted the plans for the classroom building to be built at the back of the property across the street. And this is a fadl, this is a blessing, this is a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The community, the people have said one time, the fire marshal said, man, your community, you did two of the hardest things. You built a masjid and then you're building a school. This is a ni'mah, but it is our duty and it is a job. So we have to get up and running. And things now have to be continuous. There's no stopping. Once you submit, things have to roll, or you lose a lot of money and you lose a lot of time. We had some brothers, may Allah reward them, go out trying to collect some funds. And what we found was mostly that everybody has something going on. Everybody has a mashru' that they're a part of. They want to help build a masjid here or there, a school here or there. They want to help their families or their country folks back home by doing certain things for them. And while that is all good and dandy, what it says to us the most is that we have to take care of our own here. And we have to invest here. And we have to realize this reality here. And that comes with sacrifice. And now's not the time for baloney answers or answers that don't make any sense or ones that are empty excuses. The sacrifice has to come now. And it has to come from the people who are here. You might be thinking that it's more important to do things in the motherland. Your kids, for the majority of them, they will not live in that motherland. They may go and visit. They may go for 2 months or 3 months. They may go for a portion of their life if that's where you've chosen to educate them. But their kids, their grandkids, your great-grandkids, whatever it may be, they will be living here most likely. So what are we doing to leave for them some foundation? Do we leave them on quicksand or do we leave them on cement? This is how we have to look at the situation at hand. So they went out searching for those funds, and alhamdulillah, although they collected a good amount, this has to be done here. The permit to build the building itself, by itself, is $420,000. This is construction. This is how it goes. We can't use even the parking lot until we landscape it. And our hope is that between this Jum'ah and next Jum'ah, no formal fundraiser. This is where your hearts speak, Allah is witnessing you. Allah will see what you do before you leave this masjid. But we have 2 weeks, your tax deductions will still count for 2021, for this year, to give in the way of Allah. That landscaping, we should be able to raise the funding for. The traffic signal, alhamdulillah, the community came forth in Ramadan and after. It's paid for, it's going through the politics of PG&E and all that other stuff. By next month, they should be starting the work on it, alhamdulillah. Allah has done so much to help us out. Invested so much than we have put in from our time and our energy and our wealth. Allah has done more than we have. So we need to meet that today. So delay purchasing something for 1 year. Or if you have a car payment, make that same payment, one that you will also do to the academy. Set up a monthly payment plan. Commit to something for 2 years. This is what we're asking. That you do 100 a month, or 250 a month, or 500 a month, or 1,000 a month. Three brothers, one day they were sitting and we were talking about the project. One committed to 10,000 a month for 2 years. The other 5,000 a month for 2 years. The other 2,500 a month for 2 years. Just those three over 2 years, that's $400,000. This can be built by just here in the Central Valley. And although this is a school for Stanislaus and San Joaquin counties, not just from Manteca, it's being built here, across from your masjid, across in a city, in a main thoroughfare, where it's easily accessible for you. So that the children can be brought up in an Islamic environment, instead of all of the stuff that they're being inflicted with. It's an affliction, it's a disease that they're being fed with through social media and other means. هَأَنْتُمْ هَأُولَاءِ تُدَعُونَ لِتُنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah said, behold, you are the ones who have been called to give in the way of Allah. It's nobody else. And no one's going to care for it as much as you do. So we have 2 weeks to try and get that $150,000 sum so we can get the landscaping in while the traffic signal's going in, and then inshallah we'll be able to use the parking lot. And what a beautiful ni'mah, what a beautiful blessing that would be to actually see before the month of Ramadan comes. But the time comes and you're put on the spot. Again, this is a tax deductible donation. Collecting from this week till the end of the year, till the December 31st, the credit card machines are available and we'll be accepting those donations throughout, and we'll be sending out messages for you to forward to your friends and family. If you send out one message to 10 people and one of those people gives, you get the same reward for their donation, even though that money didn't come out of your pocket per se. Spread the message, you will be rewarded for it. And we even have sisters doing that. And yet many of us are just focused on our dunya. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, give, because you are the ones who have been assigned to give. And may Allah make us of those who are blessed to fulfill our missions, to establish Islam in the land that we're in and across the world, and firmly in the hearts of our children and our youth, present and future. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات المؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك أنت سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبا على دينك يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبا على دينك يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبا على دينك سبحان ربك رب العزة يوم يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين